Welcome to Second Take, the show that takes a look at the issues behind the news. Developments at Eskom have been fast-moving since Thuli Madonsela released her State of Capture report. Terence Creamer has been monitoring the situation, and he joins me now to speak about where things stand. Welcome, Terence.
Hi, Sam.
It seems Eskom has been in the news for all the wrong reasons since the report was released on the 2nd of November.
That's correct. I think Eskom was probably aware that they were going to feature. I think they felt there was going to be more time for them to go through the process and respond, and seemed to have been taken aback by some of the observations in the State of Capture report, and I think responded quite assertively straight away. Unfortunately for them, I think their interim results were the very next day, and I think that they didn't give much thought to the way they should respond, and I think there was a view that maybe they could have taken a bit more of a sober stance and looked at the report and looked at how they could have responded through this. For instance, the commission of inquiry that is recommended by Thuli Madonsela in the report. But I think they were definitely taken aback by the way they were painted and depicted, and the way the Tegeta deal in particular was depicted. The view initially was that Brian Molefe was weighing up his options, and we saw that the chairperson, Ben Ngobani, immediately said that he reacted quite angrily and said if they lose Brian Molefe, who he had credited with stabilising the organisation, it would be on Advocate Thuli Madonsela's head. And then it did seem during that very emotional interim results presentation that Molefe was considering that he may resign. However, the very next day, the board made quite assertive statements, and Molefe was in the audience at that presentation. It looked like he was going to fight his corner. A week later, however, I think he realised how long this process could be and that it was going to weigh on him and the organisation. And I think he decided to do, I think, the correct thing and step back for the sake of the organisation. He claims that he will clear his name in the course of time, and there is a process, as I say, there is a mechanism in the form of the Commission of Inquiry to allow him to do that. The issue is whether the President will take this on review, or any other organisation mentioned or person mentioned in the organisation. And if that is the case, and if there is a judicial review, we can expect that this is going to take some time before we get to a point where a commission is ultimately assembled. And then generally, we know in South Africa these commissions take some time to deliberate, assemble and deliberate and have findings. So this was going to linger. So I think that Molefe's decision to step aside and leave the organisation is probably the correct one for the sake of Eskom.
But the report is not the only thing that's weighing on Eskom's reputation. There's also simmering unhappiness about the way the state entity has dealt with renewables.
Yes, I think that's correct. I think, Brian Molefe, his tenure is actually very short at Eskom. He could have been credited. He built up a lot of capital in society for the fact that load shedding, that dreaded word, sort of diminished under his watch. We definitely seem to see a stabilisation of the operations. Whether he should take the credit or not, there's a lot of debate about that. But there was definitely under his during his term, there was a pullback from load shedding. In fact, we're in a position, Eskom claims, and that could have been a big headline of the interim results, where Eskom is now really saying that they're open for business and wanting to get new connections and wanting industrial customers to buy more of their product. This is sort of an ironic sort of theme given where we've come from, but it was a key theme. They were saying that, Eskom was saying that with additional Madupi units coming on, with Kusile coming on, with Ngula now sort of at the final end, and with some of the other new capacity that has come on, and in light of really quite weak demand, a weak economy, in fact much weaker demand than we would ever have expected if we think back to 2008, there is this going to be the surplus that may linger until sort of 2022, 2023, and then start diminishing thereafter. But and so that could have been a big, I think, theme. However, there's so many other issues where I think Molefe and the Eskom executive maybe undermine their credibility and sight and their reputation. And one of the most obvious one, obviously, other than what happened in the coal sector and the deal with Optimum, was the way they've dealt with the issue of renewables. This very aggressive stance of not signing new renewable power purchase agreements. This is a very successful program in world terms, the renewable program run by the IPP office, which is a sort of a venture of both the National Treasury and the Department of Energy. And you know, we've seen sort of nearly 200 billion rands worth of investment come in as a result of the program, procured over 6,000 megawatts of renewables capacity. Now this has come in some ways, we've had to pay school fees up front for this new capacity. It was new technology, it was a new approach to the way we were procuring, and the first rounds did come in quite expensively. But what we're seeing in subsequent rounds, that's the irony of the situation, the ones that Eskom is now refusing to sign are priced very competitively, priced more competitively than new coal coming in from Madupi and Kusile. And that is part of a global trend that we're seeing around the world, where renewable solar and wind prices are falling, photovoltaic prices and wind, onshore wind prices are falling materially. And we're now talking about the sort of 60 to 70 cents a kilowatt hour in South African cents, which is well below other technologies. And it does raise now the debate of whether we should be pursuing a renewables first strategy, given our massive solar and our very good wind resources, backed up by other more flexible power. Now this is something that Eskom is not keen on at all. They, as we know, are very keen on a big, large-scale nuclear build, and that while there's a lot of circumspection around that because of what we saw around the Optimum deal and whether the organisation isn't captured by certain interests and whether this massive nuclear build won't be tainted by corruption. But that aside, I think South Africa needs to have a debate about the future of its electricity mix, given serious changes that are taking place in the world of electricity generation and the technologies and the way these technologies are priced. And I think the way Brian Molefe in particular has behaved towards the renewables has almost been to try and stifle that debate and to try and at all costs get this nuclear program. And I think that did raise many eyebrows and basically I think damaged he spent this very good capital that he had earned in society from load shedding that was spent through these sort of these difficult and very aggressive debates on the side.
So what is likely to happen now?
Well, a lot now hinges on the way the shareholder reacts. We haven't just seen Brian Molefe resign. We saw Mark Pomensky, who is the board member whose name always linked to the Gupta family, has also now stepped down from the board. And the board has also been diminished massively over the period. In fact, that became clear when one of the board members was responding to the State of Capture report. Several board members, and this is not a very old board, have stepped down in the last few months. So Eskom now needs to re-establish a board. I think Minister Lynn Brown, the Public Enterprise Minister, has said that this is a priority to re-establish the board. But now they also need to decide what they're going to do about the chief executive position. I think there will have to be an interim chief executive, because I think for a new board it's going to be hard to establish a process to recruit someone permanently immediately. So probably we're going to go through an interim phase, and then the new board will have to be sort of re-established, and that board will then have to follow a process of recruiting a permanent CEO. So, and I think here really it's about the way the shareholder views this, what questions the shareholder is going to ask around the criteria for this new person, this new permanent CEO, whether that person should come internally, whether it should be an external person, whether it should be a South African, whether it should be someone with utility experience from abroad, whether they want a pair of safe hands and someone who understands the political, local political environment, or whether they want someone who's seen and is willing to navigate Eskom through a major change in the electricity supply industry. In fact, the electricity industry as a whole that is starting to take shape around the world and reimagine Eskom in that. So a lot of questions for the shareholder and the board to deal with. And I think what's going to happen is we're going to see we'll see an interim phase, and then we'll have to see what sort of leadership is brought into the board and the caliber of that person and their thinking, and then ultimately the sort of caliber and temperament of person that they would like to run the organization permanently. But I think what we've come now to expect since the State of Capture report is to expect the unexpected. There's a lot of fast-moving developments, as you said in your intro, and as some commentators post-Brexit and post-Trump, they say the world seems to have all the black swans coming home to roost at once. And it's the same at Eskom. Lots of unexpected developments are happening, and I suppose we're going to have to hold on to our seats.
Thank you, Terence. That's the Second Sake Show for this week. Thank you for watching, and join us again next time for more news analysis.